Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has told a US talk show that the ground offensive in Rafah is going ahead. He says civilians will be given what he calls safe passage and move northwards. He told ABC's This Week program that captives who are still alive justify Israel's ongoing war.
We're going to do it. We're going to get the remaining Hamas terrorist battalions in Rafah, which is the last bastion, but we're going to do it, and in this I agree with the Americans. We're going to do it while providing safe passage for the civilian population so they can leave. We are working out a detailed plan to do so. And that's what we've done up to now. We're not cavalier about this. This is part of our war effort to get civilians out of harm's way. It's part of Hamas's effort to keep them in harm's way. But we've so far succeeded, and we're going to succeed again. Those who say that under no circumstances should we enter Rafah are basically saying, lose the war.
Well, in a moment, we'll speak to Hamdah Salhut, who's in occupied East Jerusalem. But first, let's go to Shihab Rattansi in Washington, D.C. And Shihab, a couple of days ago, the White House was saying that it would not support an assault on Rafah without a plan for civilians. What message did the Israeli Prime Minister have for the American people here?
Well, this was the message that they have a plan, and that plan is to evacuate civilians north. Netanyahu repeating, and in fact, he did two interviews on American television today, that one and one with Fox News, which just completed about an hour ago, a live interview, where he said, well, look, we've destroyed so much, effectively, of the area north of Rafah that the Palestinians can move there. And then he kept repeating this phrase over and over again, victory is within reach. So those were the two main messages he was trying to get across to the U.S. population, even as the Biden administration signals in various phrases, Biden calling the Israeli response and military operation over the top last week, and now an article in the Washington Post published on Sunday where administration officials say the Biden administration is closer to a breach with Prime Minister Netanyahu than ever before, even as the Biden administration briefs its friends in the media that it's unhappy or that it's not actually going to necessarily do anything.
Given the U.S. appears to be quite uncomfortable with this move by Netanyahu, what does that say about American leverage and influence over the Israeli Prime Minister at the moment?
We know that America has that leverage over the Prime Minister. In fact, actually, there was a biography of Joe Biden that just came out a few weeks back, which showed that in 2021, during the bombardment of Gaza then, Biden picked up the phone to Netanyahu and said, all right, we ran out of runway. And immediately the bombardment stopped. So Biden can use that leverage, but still does not want to use that leverage or sees no reason to use that leverage. So instead, what we're seeing is more stories being planted in the media about Joe Biden's unhappiness with Netanyahu and the Israeli operation as we get into the heat of the election season. This is what we heard at the end of last year, that the Biden administration basically gave a green light to Israel to do whatever it wanted, but was concerned about the military operations continuing into the heat of the election season. We're not there yet, but clearly the Biden administration is very concerned about swing states like Michigan, Arab American voters. And so now we're seeing more stories being planted about the unhappiness that Biden has for Netanyahu, even as that leverage is not used. It's performative still at this stage. We're told from that Washington Post article that phrase that Biden used, oh, the reaction's been a bit over the top. I mean, he's talking about alleged genocide, clearly. It's a bit over the top. That's part of this new tough language. That counts as the tough language that Biden is now employing in a bid to, you know, as the White House attempts to convince members of its base that Biden does have some kind of heart and some kind of opposition to genocide. Mm.
Very interesting indeed. Shihab Rattansi live for us in Washington, D.C. Well, let's bring in Hamdah Salhut. She's live for us in occupied East Jerusalem. So, Hamdah, as Israel readies itself for this, we think, potential attack on Rafah, what's going on politically inside Israel?
A lot of turmoil within the Israeli government. There have been constant disagreements about how the war has been prosecuted, dissent from the very top, from Israel's war cabinet, all the way to the coalition and the opposition. Remember on Friday, the Israeli prime minister had instructed both the army and the security establishment to come up with some sort of plan, and the plan would be twofold. The first part would be on how they could evacuate the civilian population out of Rafah, And the second part would be how to dismantle the remaining Hamas battalions there. The Israeli prime minister says that there are around four Hamas battalions still left in Rafah. But the question still on everyone's mind is, where are these 1.4 million Palestinians supposed to go? And when asked about it, the Israeli prime minister had said that they're working on a detailed plan, but there's been no information whatsoever as to how it is going to be executed. The Israeli Army Chief of Staff has repeated that his troops are ready to go into Rafah, but they're waiting for an answer from the government on how to evacuate the Palestinians who are there, because there are simply too many people for some sort of massive incursion into Rafah. There have been disagreements in Israel's war cabinet for weeks now, saying that Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is not actually seeing straight, that those who feel there is a total defeat of Hamas are actually not being so honest, and that coming from a war cabinet member himself. So there have been constant disagreements about what to do next within the war, within Israel's government. And now, on the heels of all of this international pressure around the operation of going into Rafah, it seems that the prime minister himself is adamant that that is simply going to happen.
Hamdah, stay with us, because as well as the potential push on Rafah, have there been other developments as well in the occupied West Bank? Because the Israeli newspaper Haaretz has been reporting that the government of Benjamin Netanyahu is also pushing ahead with a large illegal settlement in the occupied West Bank. Haaretz says 650 homes will be built just a few metres away from Palestinian houses south of occupied East Jerusalem. Far-right Israeli activists are reportedly involved in the development. Back to Hamdah and occupied East Jerusalem. And Hamdah, it appears that the Israeli leadership is presiding over a period of accelerated illegal settlement building.
That's right. Our team has been speaking to an NGO called Ir Amim. They are essentially monitoring illegal settlements and also human rights abuses, specifically in occupied East Jerusalem. And they are saying that the level at which these settlements are being advanced is unprecedented. Since October the 7th alone, they say there were 17 new plans for illegal settlements, which would be composed of around 8,000 housing units. And four of those 17 plans have been approved. So you're looking at 3,700 housing units in illegal settlements that have been approved in occupied East Jerusalem alone. Now, what else is this NGO saying? Well, they're saying that it takes quite some time for these settlements to actually be constructed, from the time a plan is conceived to the time where construction and building actually begins. There is so much bureaucracy involved that it can take upwards of 10 years. But the government here seems to be fast-tracking it quite a bit and getting involved politically. And what else is this NGO saying? Well, since the war began, they're saying that perhaps it's a distraction for the rest of the public, for the international community, that while the focus is on the war on Gaza, they are expediting essentially these settlements. And remember, this is Israel's most right-wing government in its history. They are advocates and proponents for illegal settlements, not only in the occupied West Bank, but in occupied East Jerusalem. And when the war is over, they've been advocating for settlements in the Gaza Strip too, advocating for an occupation there. Settlements are an extremely sensitive topic because they encroach on Palestinian land and they are illegal under international law. But it seems that the Israeli government is still pushing forward with these moves.
Hamdah, many thanks. Hamdah Salhut, an occupied East Jerusalem.